Hi, good morning, everyone.
Hi, Bharat.
Hi.
Hi, Bharat.
Hi. Okay, even before I start my session, I wanted to ask a question. Honest replies. How many of you are clear with linear regression? No one?
I've raised my hand, so.
How do I see that?
Hi, Bharat. I've practiced, but I'm not completely clear on it. I mean, need more. I think need to work on it more to understand it fully.
Okay. Do you guys want to cover any fundamentals again, or we can have a quick half an hour session later on perhaps clarifying doubts on linear regression?
Yeah, I think Bharat, we can have a session later. I mean, that is what I would suggest. Plus, if you could give us some pointers or some references. So is there anything like some exercises we could do on Kaggle or something that would help us understand or, you know, give us more practice on this?
Oh, perfect. Okay. So today you guys stop me exactly at 3 o'clock, or perhaps give me a hint at 2:30. I'll stop the session for logistic regression and we'll switch over back to linear regression. What I'll go through is a brief 15 minute coverage on core topics, so the core intuition behind linear regression, and then for next 15 minutes I can show you where can you find data sets on which you can practice, and then finally we can have a question answer. If you guys have any doubts, then I can clarify it in the last half an hour. That'd be
perfect.
Fine?
Yeah, works for me. Yeah,
Bharat, I have one point. Sure. Can we have some kind of exercise? I'll tell you frankly, if we, when we are going with your document, means I am going with your document, it looks fine, easy for me. Like everything is understandable and all that. But if we'll have some kind of exercise where I can do some practice and all.
Okay. So I think that's a fairly good point. So immediately starting this week, what I'll do is, so every week, like I put this up, what I will do is I'll, for each of these, let's say 15th was on linear regression, I will add right below it a place where I can give you some notebooks. I'll put at least 4 to 5 with different data sets and different type of problems. Like one of the data set would be slightly having missing values. Some of the data sets would have too large variance in values, and you can practice on those. Would that help? I'll add 5 of these every week, perhaps.
Yes, that will help.
Yeah.
Okay, done.
Thanks, Bharat.
No problem. Okay, so this week I wanted to cover logistic regression. This week, because I'm going to cut it short and move back to linear regression, I'll just cover the theory part of it. Theory is pretty interesting. It's not as dry as what linear regression was. And then after theory, we'll switch back to linear regression next week. So today I'm going to upload all the material and the practice material on logistic regression as well. So this week after the session, go through those. And what I was also thinking was it would be good to have a WhatsApp group where I can keep giving updates, or you guys, if you have any questions, you can directly post it there. So if you're fine, I can create a WhatsApp group if that would make it easy.
Yeah, that
sounds good.
Okay. I would need one volunteer who can help me form that group and add everyone to it. Can someone please volunteer?
Yeah, Bharat Lahiri here. I could help with that.
Okay, Lahiri, you'll volunteer?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so how would everyone give their numbers to you? I can, we can just put it on chat window right now and then you can note it down. Yep. Would that help? Or
yeah, that would help. I can create in that way.
Okay, so here is mine to start with. Done. Okay, create a WhatsApp group. This would help us coordinate through the week easier. And if anyone has any questions through the week, they can keep dropping the questions there and I can respond back straight away.
Yeah, okay, fine.
Okay, wonderful. So linear regression, logistic regression. We covered linear regression last week. So why do we need logistic regression to start with? I'll quickly perhaps share my... Okay, so linear regression in essence was when we were trying to fit a line through our data. Data is composed of some features. I'm just going to take one feature. Let's take an example. Number of hours studied and 2 marks scored. Now, if this was hours studied and this was marks scored, generally, you will have some data like this, each point corresponding to some marks and versus how many number of hours studied. In linear regression, what we were trying to do was we were trying to add a line to it so that given the number of hours, we could predict the number of marks scored. And the way this line was drawn by fitting an equation of this form. B would be the intercept and A would be the slope, how much it goes up for every horizontal move, or for every change in number of hours, what is the change in number of marks? That is what A is. So B was called intercept, A was called coefficient. And the way our algorithm did it was first it would draw a random line and then it would keep improving the line like this, 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 until it gets a line which minimizes error. By minimizing error, what I mean is from actual data, if this line would predict for this number of hours, these many marks, but the actual number of marks is this. So this is our predicted, which is usually denoted by y hat, minus the actual one. If we sum this for all the data points, I'll clean this up a little. So for all our data points, if I draw this, this is in essence predicted minus actual. And if I sum everything, all of these distances, that would give a measure of error in our modeling. Now the algorithm, the way it fits this line by changing A and B is to minimize this error. Now imagine a problem where you have number of hours studied versus pass or fail. Now how would your data look like? Your data would look something like this now. So you would have a lot of number of hours studied. So let's call this number of hours studied. But regardless what number of hours studied, if this was pass or fail, let's say pass is 1, fail is 0. you will have something like this. For these many number of hours, you study, you pass, you, let's say, fail. And these many, you pass. Now, regardless of what features you choose, your graph is always going to look like this. It's either going to be 0 or going to be 1. Now, with linear regression, if we try to solve this problem, linear regression would draw a line like this, and it would try to minimize these distances. Because this is going to be the error. This is what your line predicts, and this is actual. This is what the actual amount is, and this is what line predicts, and this is going to be the error. Now, there are two fundamental. Now, this is not a wrong approach. A lot of people do it, and there is absolutely no problem using this model. But there are a few problems with it. And there are much better ways to approach these kind of problems. I'm not saying linear regression is not suitable for these problems. You can use linear regression, but what I'm saying is there are much better available models. One of those models is logistic regression. Now, the problem with linear regression is sooner or later, if you extrapolate this line, it will lead to a value less than 0 or in negative domain, and it will lead to something beyond plus 1. But actual data can never go below 0 or plus 1 because it's always either pass or fail. It can be used for any classification. So the problems were what you're trying to predict. Why? Is a real number is a regression problem. So these numbers, because these are real, these can vary. There is no limit to these values. It can be 0, 1, 2, 3, 0.5, 0.6, any real number. But if y is 0 or 1, 0 can be 0, 1 can be anything like pass, fail. You're given an image. You're trying to predict whether it is a cat or not a cat. 0, 1. Whether you will buy a house or not buy a house. 0, 1. Any kind of classification where you're trying to categorize these things. If y is categorical, what you're trying to predict is categorical, you can always represent it like that. Y can only be 0 or 1. Category of interest or category which is not of your interest. These kind of problems are known as classification problems. Where y is continuous number, any real number. These type of things are known as regression problems. Now, if you read papers, how they write it is, if you see something like this, it's a classification problem. If you see something like this, it's a regression problem. What this means is y is either 0 or 1. That's all. It's bounded by between 0, 2, 0 or 1. Y is an element of R. R is all real numbers. That means any number. So I'm just telling you this because if you search internet and you come across some write-up about logistic regression, this is how mathematically people would write these things. These things may mean same as if y is a continuous number, it becomes regression. If y is 0 or 1 or any category, in fact, it becomes classification problem. Now, why I was telling all these were because of simple reason. One, the problem with linear regression is your y would not be bounded between 0 and 1 now if you use linear regression, because this line can be extrapolated to any given values. Second is, because something is bounded between 0 and 1, it can be interpreted as probabilities also. So this has fairly profound implications of how we solve any problem. So think of it this way. Number of hours studied, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, let's say 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Now, for someone who studies 12 hours, this linear model will predict a probability of pass, let's say it's 0.87. And for someone who studies 13 hours, it is going to predict some other probability, 0.97. So this difference of probability is same across any region. So even if you take probability between 9 and 10, this difference is going to be same. This is the, you remember a plus bx was the formula. This difference is always going to be b. The slope is proportional to b. That is the slope. But in real life problems, that's not how data would be. So you would often see that up till certain point, your likelihood, so up till this point, you're most likely not pass. And suddenly, if you put more number of hours, you tip over to the positive side, to the pass class. So this is something, the way the output changes by changing input is not a straight line anymore. So there is a huge, something happens in this region, which is much more sensitive to your number of hours spent. You're much likely to tip. If you take this session, change from 1 to 2 or 2 to 3 would not matter much, because you won't suddenly for extra 1 hour move from a fail to pass in this region. However, in this region, a small change in number of hours passed might tip you over from a fail category to a pass category. Now, this cannot be modeled perfectly or accurately using straight line. So for the same reason, we have another model called logistic regression. Now, this is how logistic regression would work like. I'll take the same problem. So number of hours studied. Let's call these points number of hours studied, a person failed, and then number of hours studied there, people passed. So this is pass, this is fail. Now what this shows is there is a general tendency of people to pass if they study more. If they study less, they tend to fail. And what we are looking for is a better alternative to a straight line. Now how we can draw a better fit is, now this looks like much better fit. If I draw a curve like this, an S, now this is much better than the, I'll draw it in a better way. Now this curves fits the data much better than how a straight regression line would have. So this red line solves our two problems. This would always be bounded between 0 and 1, but you see regression line could have gone much down or much above. So if you have large number of hours, it will predict something more than 1, but this curve would always be between 0 and 1. So we are looking for a curve which is 1, S shape is always between 0 and 1, and it is able to model some sensitive things. Like in this region, if you see, in this particular region, a small change in X would lead to large change in Y. So this is change in X, this is small, but your change in Y is correspondingly large. So in sensitive regions, if this is the sensitive region, it is able to model something which is with small input, the output changes by a large margin. So this S-shaped curve solves all these three problems. Now it so happens in mathematics, these S-shaped curves are called something called sigmoid curves. So sigmoid curve is any curve with all these properties. Now there are multiple sigmoid curves out there in mathematics. So the two most popular ones are called Logit curve, and second one is called Probit curve. Now due to, so let's just say, I will not go deep into why we use only Logit curve and not Probit curve. It's quite mathematical in nature, and the Probit curve is also used, but it is shown mathematically that it does not give as much accuracy as Logit for the same amount of computation. So our logistic regression relies on this type of sigmoid curve, which is called Logit curve. Now how logit curve looks like is the equation for logit curve. Don't worry about the equation and any of these things. I'll break it down into very simple terms. This is called logit curve. We had a regression curve which looked like y is equal to a plus bx. Logit curve is y is equal to 1 divided by 1 plus e raised to power a plus bx. Okay, now let's deconstruct this. Let's understand what this complicated thing looks like. So the maximum and minimum values of x can be between minus infinity to positive infinity. Now when x becomes negative infinity, this entire term becomes 1 plus e raised to power negative infinity. E raised to power negative infinity is 0. So you can check it on your calculator. Instead of infinity, put any large number. You can put 10,000 or 1,000 something. Or even in your Python, if you type e 1,000, it will give you 0 figure. Or close to 0 figure. The larger this number becomes, the closer to 0 this entire term becomes. Now if we take x as positive infinity, this becomes positive and this becomes negative. If it is positive, it would become 0, and hence if this becomes 0, 1 divided by 1 plus 0 would be 1, or y becomes 1. So until this part we are clear. Same way, if we substitute a positive infinity, this becomes 0 because this term becomes 1 divided by 1. This becomes minus 1. So 1 divided by 0 would, wait a second. I think I myself have mumbled a bit. You have y is equal to 1 by 1 plus e raised to power minus a plus bx. Now we are trying to find the maximum minimum values. So we will substitute the maximum possible value of x, which is infinity. So this entire terms becomes infinity. And when this entire terms becomes infinity, e raised to power, this also becomes infinity, very large number. 1 divided by something very large will always tend to 0. And if we provide negative infinity, this term becomes 0, and hence 1 divided by 1 plus 0 will tend to 1. So y is always between 0 and 1. So our this condition is solved, that we wanted a curve which should always be bounded between 0 and 1. So that is why this equation takes this form. Now, do you need to remember that? Not really. Why am I going through this? Is because of a simple reason. In linear regression, you had this form, y is equal to a plus bx. You could interpret a and b as, a as, right, if x is 0, y would still be equal to a. That was what a meant. So let's say if this is marks and this is number of hours studied, A would mean even if you don't study at all, you are bound to get some minimum number of marks. That is A. And B is, for every additional X that you have put in, what is the change in Y? So what is the change in marks for every additional hour that you have put in studies? Now, this was what logistic regression was. This was what linear regression was. For logistic regression, our curve becomes like this, and our equation is this. The way you would interpret A and B is, if you shuffle this, I'm just inverting this. You don't need to remember this. I'm just telling, I'm just taking quick 1 minute to explain the interpretation of A and B. Ideally, Python does all of these, but I'm trying to get an intuition around it. So ultimately, a plus bx takes a form of log y by y minus x. Y in our case was a classification problem. So y is generally what? What is y? Something happening or not happening. So y is, let's say, probability of pass. 1 minus 1 would always become probability of fail because it's inverse. It's either pass or fail. So a plus bx is, instead of B being rate of change of your y with x, now B becomes rate of change of this entire term. So now your B becomes, if you change your x by a small margin, this changes by B amount. Now, what is this? It's log of probability of pass divided by probability of fail. Now, this term is called something log odds ratio. This is called odds ratio, probability of something happening versus probability of something not happening. Probability of something not happening is probability of something happening, 1 minus probability of something happening. This is the same as this. This is called odds ratio, and you put log next to it, it's called log odds ratio. For the same reason that if you go ahead and read more about it, you will hear these terms. That's why I explained, but otherwise you don't need to remember any of this. As long as you remember one thing, that our linear regression fitted the data like this. Logistic regression fits the data with an S-shaped curve. In linear regression, by tweaking A and B, we could change the line like this, the direction of line, to fit the data better. How do we fit the data better? By minimizing the difference between what we predicted and what actually was. In here, the equation becomes this. And same way, by changing A and B, our curve shifts like this. It might either become smooth curve like this or become a sharper curve like this. So our computer would try to compute the distance of actual minus predicted minus actual by changing A and B, same way as how we did in linear regression, but instead of changing the line from here to here to here to here, it changes the curve from being a smooth curve to a little more tighter curve to exactly what fits the data. That is all you need to understand about logistic regression to be able to use it. Now there is one more concept I want to discuss before I show you how it is done in on a data set. So you have x number of R studied, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Let's say we have 10 data points. You have fail, 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 pass, fail, pass, 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 pass. Now let's say y hat, this y, is what your algorithm predicts now. Now, how do we measure? Earlier, we had these y and y hat as some numbers. So y was always, let's say, 0.23, and what your algorithm, y was 23, your algorithm predicted 25. So you could calculate a distance, like 2 is the error. Now here, how do you find the error? So to circumvent that problem, you define something called, so this is how a matrix would look like. These are actual values. These would be predicted. So actual pass, actual fail. How many are actual pass? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 were fails. Actual fails were 5. Pass. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 were pass. What was the predicted one? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 failed. So predicted pass, predicted fail. Predicted fail is 5. Pass, 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 pass. Predicted pass is 5. Now, how do we fill up this matrix? Is out of the actual pass, how many did we predicted passed? So actual pass were these, this, and these. Out of the actual 5, we predicted only 4 as pass. So actual pass and our predicted pass becomes 4. And this becomes 1. So we predicted 4, which were actually pass, and we predicted pass, which was actually fail, 1. Same way, we predict failure for these ones. How many actual failed? 4. So we predicted fail and actual fail, 4. But we predicted one failure wherein actual it was pass. Now this matrix is little confusing, and believe me, I'm kidding you not, this is actually called something called confusion matrix. So confusion matrix would, as how in linear regression we had a term, we used to calculate actual minus predicted as our error criteria. We use something called confusion matrix to measure how good our algorithm is. Now in this case, if we want to measure how good our algorithm is, how would we measure? So we have few scores. First score is called accuracy score. Accuracy score is how many did we get right. So out of the total 10, we got these two wrong. We got this one wrong and we got this one wrong. So 8 were right out of 10. So 8 were wrong out of 10. Our accuracy becomes 80%, 8 by 10. Now this can also be calculated like anything in this diagonal divided by total number. So why this diagonal? We predicted fail, we predicted pass, it was actual pass, 4. This is the correct number. We predicted fail, it was actual fail, 4. This was also correct. So total becomes 8 by 10. 80% accuracy is the accuracy of this model. Now, can we actually rely on only accuracy of the score? Think about it. Let's say if a model, let's take a hypothetical example. You are building a model which scans everyone in the airport and tries to predict, and this is one of the projects I'm working on, so I'm taking an example. It tries to scan all the faces appearing in the camera, and it tries to predict the number of terrorists. Okay, so let's say in this toy example, our small airport, we have 10 people coming. And in these 10 people is hidden 2 terrorists. And your algorithm's job is to identify these 2 terrorists. So this is how our model looks like. This is actual and this is predicted. Let's say in actual, so person 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Person 1, was he a terrorist? No, 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 no. Let's say 6th one was a terrorist. 8th, 7th one was not. 8th one was a terrorist. Now, let's say your algorithm says no one is a terrorist. Everyone is fine. Allow everyone. What is the accuracy of your algorithm?
100%.
So these are predicted values of X and these are actual values of, or let's call this a good and a terrorist. Actual good and a terrorist. How many actual goods were there? 8. How many terrorists? 2. How many predicted good? All 10. How many terrorists we detected? 0. So if I was to fill up this matrix, how many of my predictions were actually good? 8. How many of my good predictions were terrorists? 2. How many of my terrorist predictions were actually good? 0. Because we didn't predict any terrorists. How many of these were actually terrorists? 0. If I were to calculate my accuracy, it would become 8 plus 0 by 10. The model has a staggering accuracy of 80%. But can you say this model was any good at all? It just blindly allowed everyone in. It didn't detect anyone. So what this tells us is accuracy is not as reliable statistic as it is projected to be. A lot of times in your businesses or wherever you work, you might have a lot of things called KPIs or some measurements. And a lot of them measure only something called accuracy. This is a major fallacy in accuracy, where if out of the total number of observations, what you are trying to predict is small, your accuracy will always be a high figure, but your model would be as good as garbage. So in this case, to circumvent that, to get better measures, along with accuracy, we take two figures. One is called precision. The other one is called recall. Now there are quite a lot of these model measurements available, but the most popular ones are precision and recall. Precision is how precise your model is. So by definition, what does it mean when I say how precise your model is? Precision would mean out of all the things that your model predicted, how many were actually right is called precision. Okay. So precision would mean out of all the actual terrorists, out of all the things that you call terrorists, how many were actual terrorists? Out of the all things that you call terrorists, how many were actually terrorists? That will give you how precise your model was. In our case, of all the ones that we predicted as terrorists, 0. How many were actually terrorists? 0. While our accuracy is 80%, our precision drops to 0%. Recall is how good the model is in real life. That means of all the actual terrorists, how many is our model able to catch? So of all the terrorists, how many is our model able to catch? All the terrorists, 2. How many is our model able to catch? 0. 0%. So while accuracy is 80%, our precision recall values are 0. So always be cautious when someone just gives an accuracy figure as proof of something being good. It's not an absolute measure. It's not the only measure. It won't give you the right picture of things. With accuracy, always look for precision and recall figures to get a full gauze of how good an algorithm is. Okay, so I think we have enough theory behind us now to truly to get working on one of the real life, not real life, we'll still take some toy data and then we can improve on it as we understand it better.
Bharat, I had a question.
Yeah.
Regarding the classifications, is it limited to only, is it like a binary classification only, 0 or 1, or can it be?
It can actually be any sort of calculation. I'll show you how. So let's say you have something beyond binary. What can we call it? So, okay, you're given a bunch of, okay, you're given a lot of movies. Okay, and and you have various parameters on these movies, like a genre count or something. And what you're trying to predict is a score of the movie. It can be good, average, or bad. Now, this is something that is classification still, because this is not a real number. This is still classified. This is still ordinal in nature. That means it is categorical. You have your, what you're trying to predict is categorical in nature. You're trying to predict whether movie is a good movie, average movie, or a bad movie. In this case, how would you derive something like an accuracy score or a precision score? Same way. Our matrix expands. These are actual values. These are predicted values. How many of what I predicted good were actually good? Let's say there were overall 10 good movies. I predicted 8 of them as good, one of them as average, one of them as bad. Same way, there were totally 12 average movies. Out of them, I predicted correctly 9 of them. 2 of them I classified as good, one of them as bad. 10, 9, 1, 0. In this case, accuracy becomes what I called good and is actually good. What I call average is actually average. What I call bad is actually bad. 8 plus 9 plus 9 divided by the total number of movies we analyzed. This becomes accuracy score. Now, how do we calculate precision? Precision is always calculated as one versus all. So let's say we will redraw this matrix as everything that we predict as good and rest. Rest would become average plus bad. Average plus bad. So this stays 8. And now what I call good but was something else would become 2. And same way, I'll add all of this and fill up this. What I call good but was something else would be sum of all these. In this case, it would become 20, 32. 32 minus 8 would be this value. And same way here, it becomes 30. And you calculate precision for good. Same way you calculate precision for bad, precision for average. Now you average these three figures out and you get a precision score. Same way for recall, you average three recalls and you get recall score. Now there are some nuances to it, because you have asked, I'm explaining. You have now three recall scores, recall for A, recall for average movie, recall for bad movie. Now, if you add a weight to it, it's called a weighted recall or weighted precision. If you just add these three divided by three, it's called a global precision or global average. Same way, there is something called macro and micro. But all of this is really very nuanced, in sense if you're too much into statistics is where you would worry about all these things. But in general, you would never hand calculate these. You would generally, okay, just as I would show in algorithm, you would just as how we did for linear regression, dot coefficients would give you the score. Here, dot report would give you precision, recall values all listed. You just need to understand what precision and recall are. And more importantly, why do you need to use precision and recall along with your accuracy scores? But all of, okay, this you would never hand calculate. This was just for your information on, if you want to cross check, how does it work to build an intuition around it?
Yeah, I just had one more additional question to this. So how would you represent this problem, right? Good, average, bad on a curve, because before this, what we had was an S curve, which was binary in nature, right?
Now you're testing my drawing skills a little too far for my comfort, but I will try to draw it.
Okay. To be honest, I'm trying to link it to the features versus predictor in multi-dimensions.
I'll talk in the same language then. So there are two features now, X1, X2. There might be hundreds of these features, but we can visualize only three-dimensional. So earlier when I was explaining only X versus Y, now I will try. I'm not sure whether I can draw it correctly, but let me try. So I'm drawing something with two features. Okay, these two features, let's call it X1, X2, and what we are trying to predict is Y. Let's say number of hours studied plus number of hours.
Marks. Okay.
And Y would be marks. Y would be, let's say, pass or fail, because we are trying to classify things. So our curves would look like these. So this is X1, this is X2. Number of hours studied, number of hours of practice put together. Now imagine two surfaces, two planes. One on top of each other. Okay. So this is at ground level. This is a little up. So this becomes a three-dimensional plane. So for people who would have generally studied higher, would come this side of the x-axis, and a little more of practice would come this. So you would see all the people somewhere here. This plane is marking all the people who passed. All the people who would fail would come here. So now this becomes 3D. Imagine you're putting a paper. This is your paper. You're putting a paper on ground, and these are the plots. These are the people who have failed. And above in air, you have another piece of paper where you mark all of these. These dots would mark people who have passed. What our computer would do is, instead of an S curve, it would draw S shape plane now. So extend this curve this side and outside this. So now you will have an S shaped plane. And this plane is what is called the linear regression. So instead of A plus BX, you will have A plus B1X plus B2X2. Same like linear regression. I'll see if I can show it here. Yeah, here. So think of it as this plane now. This looks better. Where is that figure found? Yeah. So can you see this plane now?
Oh. Yeah.
Yeah, it would take the form. This is linear regression because this is plane. This becomes an S-shaped. While in two-dimensional, it was just an S-shaped line. Now it has taken a form of a plane. So all the red points become pass. All the blue points become fail. And that's how a computer would differentiate. This is what an algorithm does at the backs, in the behind the screen. Does this answer your question?
Yeah, sort of, but my question was more on terms of categories. So we are still predicting pass and fail over here, right? We are not predicting good, average, or bad.
What you can do is, as I said, you can always have a one versus all, because it's very difficult to visualize. Visually, you cannot visualize more than two.
Right.
So you have one plane here, one plane here. So for two categories, our dimensionality has become three dimension. Correct. For one category, we had just one line where we can differentiate. So here is how I will explain it. for two dimensions, for two categories, pass or fail, our figure become three-dimensional. If we add one more category, this becomes actually four-dimensional, because you cannot represent it only by two surfaces. There were two surfaces. One was for pass, one was for fail, and you could observe it in three-dimensional. But if you have more number of these categories, it becomes four-dimensional, five-dimensional, and n-dimensional. So for n number of categories, it would always be n plus one-dimensional figure. But these are some things we cannot visualize or think of. We are limited only by three dimensions. But mathematically, these can be represented on equations, and that's how your algorithm sorts it.
Okay. Okay.
Can we see it and visualize it? No.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Got it. Got it.
Okay. I should check this website out. It looks very interesting. I'll try to recreate these. And I think this is an R code. You cannot implement it in Python. Mutate, expand, grid, or R. So anyone who's working on R can try it. I can convert this into Python code and give it to you. I'll write it down perhaps myself and post it. Okay, so I want to quickly go through example. Okay, this all is the same theory which I have covered, and here I have just taken some data set which is called default data set. Is it gives a probability of default, and it has so probability of default.
Bharat, either sorry to interrupt. Can you zoom the screen
here?
Yeah, so thank you.
Our this data set gives one thing to be predicted. This is default. Either people default or they don't default. So yes, no type of it's a yes, no type of problem. That means it's a categorical problem, and that's why we would use logistic regression. So if you see, default has yes or no. Now it also has another category. These three are predictors. It gives income balance. By balance, what it means is on a credit card, how much is the outstanding balance? So zero means there is no outstanding balance. Everything is paid. And then it gives another category, whether the person who has the credit card is a student or not. And this gives probability of someone defaulting on credit card bill payment. The actual data set has 230 of these parameters, and this was a competition launched by Citibank to predict likelihood of someone defaulting on a credit card. And there was this group from US, a 3-person student group, who prepared the model, and it reached accuracy of 98%+. And Citibank eventually purchased this model from those students and started using it as their model. Before giving out a credit card, it would run through all these parameters, and then it would decide whether a person should be, applicant should be given credit card or not. So that's the background. Out of that, I've subsetted only these three. I have not taken all the 230 parameters or included in original data set. I've just taken three. And also it was like 3 million big data, but I have taken only 1,000 rows of it, the first 1,000 rows. So as usual, you will first start by importing all the libraries. I will include this command to render the plots inline. Seaborn for our visualization. what type of file it is. It is a .xls file. So I will read it as read_excel. Now it has read the first column as well. I don't want it to read it. So I can read the documentation by pressing Alt Tab. It says index column. I will assign the 0th, the first column. In Python, everything starts with 0. So the first column becomes 0. And I'm classifying that as index. Okay, I have this data now. So as an example, if I want to plot balance versus default, this is just to show how the graphs look like. X on Y, I want default. See exactly how our data would look like for, and if we try to predict a linear regression and try to put a straight line. Now I'm not going to show it here because I've already given all the code here and you can try it out. Our regression line would look like this. And as I said, we always have the problems that it would go below zero. So here it's going below zero. And for large people with large outstanding balance, eventually it will cross one. And these numbers will give will lead to predictions which are beyond one and less than zero, which cannot be then interpreted as probabilities. And that's why we use a S-shaped curve of this formula. Let's actually try. So here I have given some code on if we choose a random number of A and put Y is equal to this equation, this is how the curve looks like. So you can try experimenting with different values of A and B and then see. So if A is extremely small, you see the curve would have shifted. And if A was large, this thing goes a little more, so the change in this becomes steeper and steeper. Same with B, it would shift. See, it has shifted so much that like we cannot see the full of it, but this is exactly the middle part of the S. The rest of the S would have gone here and here, but it still would be between 0 and 1. So that's how these curves look like. Putting something on logistic regression is same as simple as model.fit. But before that, as with anything, we'll first start with analysis of our data set. It has 10,000 rows, 4 columns. First thing I want to know is...
Sorry, Bharat, could you zoom a bit?
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yes. So first thing I'm going to see is what are the type of categories. So column 0 is, so first thing I see is there are no missing values, so I don't need to worry about that. The first three things are objects. The first two are objects because these are not numbers. These are categorical in nature, and next two are numbers. I can see more information about these as if I describe this, I will get more information about count. Because these two are categorical, things like mean standard deviation would not mean much, so it has ignored and it has just taken balance and income. Second thing I do is pair plot. So it has drawn a pair plot between everything and each, all of the categories. It has ignored the categorical ones. You can actually include everything and do that. This is called a univariate. For single thing, you are trying to see how the distribution looks like. What you also generally would do to detect outliers is draw a box plot. So let's say if I'm trying to draw a box plot of balance. This has some sort of outliers, but you know, like linear regression, we don't suffer much from outliers from in while using logistic regression. That is because of one simple thing, because of the shape of the curve. I'll show it to you. Now, in logistic regression, we always had some data and we fit a line. Now, imagine a particular observation which is outlier, very high in value. This has an effect because your algorithm works by minimizing these distances. Because of this distance being large, it would actually try to, and this distance would be so much that it would be more than sum of all these differences. So your line will get skewed from here. The line might actually go, your algorithm would draw something like this instead, just because of this outlier. And hence we always, we were required to do some sort of outlier treatment. Now for logistic regression, we don't suffer much from outliers because our data any which ways would always be in this shape. Regardless what the outlier is, it might actually be here, but it's always going to be between pass or fail, between 0 and 1. So if these are number of hours studied, so you have much someone who studied quite high, or 24 hours he continuously studied, he didn't sleep or do anything. But your curve will still look like this curve, regardless of outlier. And hence logistic regression is a little more robust to outliers. So unless this was very, very heavy, I'm not going to bother much about cleaning it or doing anything about it. These type of things are univariate, and this is a bivariate, how one thing varies with other. What would be interesting to see is how default depends on balance also. So balance and income. So if I plot a scatter plot, and on x-axis I put balance, y-axis I put income, and then I want to change the color based on default. Now this tells me if I look at income and balance together and then try to infer something, these type of visualizations are bivariate. Together, univariate analysis and bivariate analysis constitute first step of attacking any problem, that is exploratory data analysis. So here what I see is people with large outstanding balances tend to default. People with low outstanding balance do not tend to default. Is there anything to do with income? Not really, but it's a little more denser towards lower part than higher part. So people with higher income and with less outstanding balance are less likely to default. People with low income and higher outstanding balance are more likely to default. If one of these conditions changes, the equation changes. People with low income but low outstanding balance also do not default. So you have to read these two together and then arrive at some sort of mental model on what you are looking at. So what this tells me is balance is largest influencer on predicting, has largest prediction power when trying to predict default, and your income has some sort of prediction power, but it's not as much as default. So how can we check that? Well, we can do the same thing. I want to draw this box plot, but instead I want to put a color to it. Why is it not drawing? I'm trying to find out just like color, what is in it for in matplotlib library. Oh, U is in SNS. Okay. So if your kernel is running too long, so this thing turns empty. If it's just a plain circle, if it's available, that means nothing is running. If it turns black, means something is running. And let's say you do something wrong and it causes your algorithm to go into a spiral, into a loop. That's when it keeps running. You can actually press this to interrupt a kernel. This is where you have interrupted it, and it will give you exactly at what step step did you interrupt. So let's do it again. sns.boxplot. See, I've interrupted it, and then it turned blue again. It turned empty again. So I want a box plot. I want x. X means vertical side to be balance, and I want y to be default. Yeah, there it is. So you see, for balance, people who have large outstanding balance tend to default more. This is how default would look like. And if I do the same thing for income, there is, okay, let's align it vertically. Orient. There is a way to orient it. I have to read the documentation to see exactly how you oriented it. But what I meant to show you was orient V and H. V means vertical. Something that is going wrong, but usually you can orient it. But what I wanted to show is, while for balance you have very good segregation, you can see mean balance of around between 500 to 1000 people are not defaulting. But when your outstanding balance goes beyond 1500, people tend to default. It does not mean to say people with this balance do not default. You have these people as well. These all are actually numbers. This is just 25th percentile, 75th percentile. This is all the range, but maximum is concentrated in this area, and there is a clear segregation. But for income, there is no clear segregation like this. And that's why I said balance have more predictive power than income. You see, from left to right, I'm more able to clearly distinguish between these. If I draw a line here, I can distinguish, but there is no such line I can draw here, which will help me break this into two clear planes of default and not default. So I've made up some sort of idea around I need logistic regression and balance plays an important factor. Now it all comes down to defining your X, Y, and then importing your library. So same way as you usually import your linear regression from same model, I would import from sklearn.linear model, import logistic regression. Let's call it model logistic regression. Model.fit. I have to give X and Y. So I'll first, before this, I will first define X. X is equal to, these parts would be my X and this would become my Y. So I would define X as df. Instead of selecting these three, I can just drop a column. And I want to default from the first axis. Let me check. Yeah, it looks fine. And I want Y to be what I'm trying to predict. You remember I had to fill this all the time. So I can either do reshape, or because it's just one, I can just do a flatten. Now if I see Y, it's an array. Let's try to pass this directly. So I want to do model.fit between X and Y. Okay, one more thing. We have to convert everything into numbers. That's why it says could not convert string into float. So if we see, default is no, yes. Student is no, yes. We want to convert these into ones and zeros. Now there are many ways to convert it. I've shown you when you were doing replace values with something. Easier way, and what I would recommend is go through, start getting used to something called pipelines. So I've given some pipelines here on how to use these pipelines. They was also included in a logistic regression notebook in pre-processing part. So use those instead of taking an easier approach, because later on you would want to automate all of these things. So what I've done is, I'll go through this step by step so that later you can do it yourself. Okay. So what's happening here is, first I've constructed a pipeline. So in this pipeline, I want to have, so, you know, I don't want to change anything in balance and income. I just want to change default and student. So I have to create a pipeline which is dependent on columns. So for that, I would first import pipeline, then import a column transformer. So full pipeline is column transformer, and I want to apply something to only 0th and first column. And what do I want to apply? I want to apply an ordinal encoder. Ordinal encoder is where something gets converted into 0 and 1. Or if you have three categories, it converts it into 0, 1, 2, 3, as many numbers as possible. And have you guys gone through this in your linear regression notebook? Do you have any doubts? You want me to go through it, or you're fine with these things? So I assume you guys are fine with these things.
I think we can move ahead for now. We can ask you any specific questions if we have, but I think for now we can just you can give an overview and we can move on.
Okay. So this is just what I'm trying to do is first thing I'm creating pipeline so that I don't have to constantly do it. Usually what I do is I create lot of pipelines and always store it somewhere as a different at a different place. And regardless of the data, I always know that if I want to do something like convert yes and no into 0-1, I would quickly copy paste that part of the code. If I want to scale it between minimum and maximum, I would have a pipeline for it. So it becomes very easy to reuse. Instead of spending time on pre-processing and creating this data, I always have these pipelines ready and I just copy paste this. So it becomes very easy. I can focus on problem solving instead of setting up my data for solving the problem. So in essence, what it does is first step, it creates a pipeline. So step one is getting some sort of pipeline to create from to change yes, no to 0 and 1. Now, how do I do that? First, I'll have to import pipeline, first step to be able to use pipeline. Second, from wherever you imported these, there is a pipeline called ordinal encoder. Ordinal because these are ordinal values. Yes, no have no specific order to it. Yes does not mean more than no. So you use ordinal encoder, or you can use something called label encoder as well. Label binarizer if there are two values, or label encoder. All of these have same effect. So I choose ordinal because if you have more than three types of categories, then also ordinal can take care of it. Now I want to change these two on ordinal encoder. So what do? I first build a pipeline. This part of the data builds the pipeline. My full pipeline is where I need not worry about telling it what exactly to apply to where. I should be able to give the entire data set and it should give me exactly these two changes and it should not touch these two. So here I have defined that. Let's break it down. So my full pipeline is first a column transformer. Column transformer would tell exactly what to do on what columns. Okay. So I'm clear that I want ordinal encoder on first two columns. So here is what I write. First, I give any name. It can be anything. It can be any name. This is just name for what you're trying to do. Just like defining a variable. It does not matter. This comes from what is the function I'm trying to apply. I'm trying to apply ordinal encoder. And this tells on which columns do I want to apply. I want to apply on this 0th column and first column. And I want the remainder of the columns to not be touched. And that's why I use something called pass through. So this is construction of full pipeline. Now, if I do a model fit.transform, full pipeline fit.transform, it would transform. So let's do this actually. This is full pipeline. It has actually fitted, but we want it to transform as well. Fit would only calculate values. Fit underscore transform would calculate as well as transform these values. Now you see everything has been, so this is 0, 0, 0, 1, but it comes in these weird shapes and I want it as a data frame. So let's call it temporary table. It gets converted to data frame, but you see column values have been lost. So I can put columns is equal to original data frame columns. So whatever columns were for DF, I will use those instead of typing it again and directly pass it here. So I'm just saving myself a lot of timing, a lot of typing. So I don't know, good coders are usually hardworking, but I tend to be very lazy. Whatever minimizes my work, I try to find the best way of minimizing my work. This saves me typing. Instead of typing out all columns, I could have actually done this. Default student, same way, x1, x2, whatever I want to type, and these would get converted to columns. But instead, I already had something ready hand, df, and df.columns will give me columns for df, and I want to use the same thing. I've just passed it back and I have called it as data. So now if I see df versus data, what you will see is these have been converted to zero. You see this one got converted to, this yes got converted to one, and these have been left untouched. So regardless what the problem is, if I want something to be, let's say I get a bigger data set and I want first three columns to be changed this way, all I need to do is go to my transformer and add one more column here. Or if I want to scale these by, if I want everything to be multiplied by 100, I can define another pipeline. Instead of remainder pass through, I can add another pipeline. Let's say test pipeline. I can choose something like label encoder or whatever is the pipeline that I'm trying to choose, and I can give it column. I want the second column to be transformed using that method, and rest of them to be untouched. So all I need to do is go ahead and change my pipeline. I need not actually type everything again or go and sort through all data again. That's why I wanted you guys to be comfortable using this. In linear regression notebook, I have made this, I have made very detailed notes on this. But still, if you're not able to follow, put your questions on the WhatsApp group. Let's try to solve it together. No worries. The entire objective is for you guys to learn, not to finish the course. So we'll go slowly. Even if it requires some more extra classes or postpone some of the topics and cover, I'm totally fine with that. But what I want to be sure is you guys understand before you move forward. So in linear regression, apart from understanding linear regression, you should also understand exploratory data analysis. You should also have the ability to transform columns as and when you want to change these. And there are many ways to change it. Like you could have actually done this df. Now you want to subset it by default is equal to yes. Now this would actually default, this would actually subset everything by yes, and then I can save it to, let's say, temp1 default is equal to 1. I've changed this. Same way I can do for no, and then merge these back. What am I doing? No. And then again, I can merge these back and again get the same effect. But this is quite a lot more typing, and these techniques are not reusable. That means as your data changes, you will need to again type these back manually. Or there is even more simple type of default dot replace. Now you can tell what to replace. I want to replace yes by one. This would have exactly same impact. But why I was insisting on you learning column transformations is, now imagine these were only two places where you did that. You know, when I told you the original data set has 230 plus of these features, how many will you do it? Like, even if you take about half a minute to do for each of the columns, 230 by half, you will be wasting 1 hour only to do this. when you are solving some complex problems and you have quite a lot, you would never want to take these approaches where you are doing things one by one. If there is something that is repeatable, it's always better to use a procedure which is repeatable in nature. And that's where these column transformers come into picture. So go through the linear regression notebook, make yourself very comfortable. If you're not,
Bharat, one question. How does it decide yes is one and no is zero? Have you given that as a parameter?
No, but you have the ability to do that. But as you would see, regardless what you do, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't affect your model which one is yes. Because ultimately, that's why we are using ordinal encoder. The reason it is called ordinal encoder is this yes, no doesn't have implicit order in it. So yes is not greater than no, no is not less than yes. And hence it can be zero or one or zero. It doesn't really matter.
Okay. And when if we had a third option in default, randomly, say yes, no.
Yeah, it will
yes,
randomly.
One, maybe.
Yeah, it okay. will randomly put 0, 1, 2 to all of these.
Okay.
So okay. In, because there is no order, when it puts 0, 1, 2, 3, the algorithm knows that it's an ordinal encoder, and hence 0, 1, 2, 3 would not mean 3 is greater than 0. It's ordinally encoded. So inherently all your algorithms would understand that, and it would not place more importance to 3 than to 2. So that for the same reason, you need not mention which one to be what. But however, the algorithm gives you that access to do that.
Okay. And we can use this pipeline to do any sort of data munching, right? Like yes. replacing null values or putting median value in wherever we find a null or something like that. All of that can be done via this column, via the pipeline, right?
Yes. In fact, when you're actually developing your algorithms, what you would do is you would often never put one algorithm to solve a problem. Let's say you understand 10 algorithms. What you would do is, because it's just a computer, you would put all the 10 algorithms one by one and then compare the accuracy values and pick the model which suits, which gives you the highest possible accuracy. Okay. So what you would do is you would actually do this. Let's say I name it as random forest model. Here, just like how we did model is equal to, where did we do that? So when we define model is equal to logistic regression, instead of doing model dot fit like this, we would put that as a part of pipeline. Here I would type model and I want the entire data to go through it. So I would leave it like that. So a full pipeline in the end would always include you with the model as well. And once everything is done, you just do prediction. So when you get comfortable using pipelines, this is what I will move towards, including the model also in the pipeline. And you would build, let's say you have 10 algorithms. For each algorithm, you would have same amount of same type of transformations, but this would keep changing. So you would run 9 different pipelines and compare the accuracy, precision, recall scores for all these 9. That's how in general it is done.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. So where was I? Did we convert everything properly? Okay. Now that this is converted, I want model is equal to logistic regression. Have I defined my X? Yeah. Have I defined my Y? Yes. Okay. So X has to be redefined on data. Data.draw default. X looks fine. Okay, let's try to use this way and see what happens. So our model is logistic regression. I've already instantiated it here. All I need to do is model dot fit. So you see all the 90% of the steps like exploration, changing the data, munging the data, and then dividing it into X and Y. Dividing into test train also has to be done, but I've skipped here because that was not the focus. But ideally, that would be the first step. You'll have to divide it into test train. So you have taken X and Y, and all at the end you do is model dot fit, and then you pass your X and Y values to it. Okay, and that was it. So model dot. Now you can see coefficient. So because we had three predictors, our equation would be 1 divided by 1 plus e raised to power a plus b1 x1, x1 is student, b2 x2, b3 x3. Do you need to know all this? Really not. What would you really do? So what? Coefficient is 4 point into 10 to power 3. So 0.004. So what? All I need to care about is model.predict. All I want is my model to predict good. Model.predict. And it just needs x values. So let's call this y predicted. Now I want to compare this to actual y. This is my actual y. So what is the accuracy here? In fact, I'll put it clearly. So row names, my row names are predicted. Okay, so these rows are the ones that are predicted. This Y, the columns are actual. So my accuracy is 9609 plus 62 divided by all of these figures. My model has performed at 96.71% accuracy. So of all the actual defaults, were how many? 271 plus 62. My model was able to, so accuracy you got right. How many did we get right? How many did we say default and actually defaulted? How many did we say would not default and actually did not default? This plus this divided by all these four figures. That's the accuracy score. Now you remember accuracy can be a little misleading. Let's try to calculate how many of the ones. So let's try to calculate recall. precision. What is precision? Precision measures our model's ability, how precise our model is. So of all the ones that we said would default, how many did actually default is the precision. So of all the ones that we said would default, that is 58 plus 62 is what we said would default. How many did actually default? 62 actually defaulted. Now you see, while my model prediction is 96.71%, and this is, I'm not saying it's mathematically wrong figure, I'm just saying it gives a false sense of comfort. So while the model correctly predicted 96.71% of all the things that you can see here, We have predicted abnormally large number of things. But what is the value of model is truly given by this precision score. Of how many did we say that would default, how many actually defaulted? So we said 58 plus 62, that is 5 plus 7, 1200. 58 plus 62 is 120 would actually default. But out of 120, only 62 actually defaulted. Now, why would it matter to you? If you were running a business, if this was the case, you would never accept this model, right? Because if you're saying so many people would default and only these many people are defaulting, and then you put some threshold and you deny these people loans or credit cards, this is a lost business for you. You could have actually given business to these 58 people, but because of your model, you did not give them credit cards. This is a lost opportunity. This is lost business for you. So this is how you should actually think. When you deploy a model in production and you're doing live predictions, these are the kind of things that you need to explain, that because of this model, you have these many false positives, true negatives, or this is your model precision score. This precision unfortunately means these 58 have to be sacrificed. Like, this is what this model predicts. What is the recall of the number of people who actually defaulted? How many was my model able to capture? How many people actually defaulted? 271 plus 62. 333. Of these, what percentage was I able to calculate? Was I able to catch? 62 of them I was able to catch. You see, this model actually is terrible. Terrible when it comes to actually predicting the defaulters. Total 333 people would have defaulted. That is this plus this. But of that, how many actually I caught, this model caught? Only 62. So now you realize that while accuracy is 96.71%, it looks stellar performance. But when you look at measures like accuracy, precision and recall, it truly gives you how good your model is. So if you are trying to give your model or deploy your model in a place where you're trying to predict probability of a default, this model is actually very terrible because of this score. Of the number of people who actually default, your model is able to catch only a small percentage of it, or actually 18.6% of the actual defaults is what your model is catching. It's not catching rest of them. So this is how you analyze output of any given model. So up until now, how we started was we first learned how to visualize graphs, how to get a hang of data. This entire part of visualizing data, getting a hang of data, is called exploratory data analysis. Second part is where you clean the data. If there are any missing values, you fill them up or you discard the data. If there are any outliers, you decide whether you want to treat them or not. If you decide to treat them, how do you want to treat them? This all becomes, and all of this using pipelines, this becomes part of your cleaning of data. Third step is application of data to putting your data into these predictive algorithms. Now you know two algorithms, linear and logistic. Final step is to assess performance of a model. This is what we have done today, assessing performance using measures like accuracy, recall, and precision. Now you really need not do all of this by hand. You need not calculate all of this, or you need not even put a cross tab. From sklearn, same, there is a library called metrics. From here you can import whatever you want. So I want to import from this library accuracy score. I want precision. I want confusion matrix. Let's check if it has precision. Precision recall curve. It has quite a lot of things. Precision score. Let's see if there's a recall score. Okay, I've imported all of this. Now all I need to do is model.confusion matrix. How do I use this? I need to pass again x, y predicted and y.
No, I don't think you need model.
Yeah, I've just put confusion matrix. I've given y predicted values from previous. Here is where I stored all the y predicted values. I've given y. If you see, this is exactly the same thing. What we drew by PD cross tab, y predicted y. If we just put confusion matrix, y predicted y, it gives you the confusion matrix. Same way, you can have precision score, recall score. And the best part is there's something called model.accuracy, model.summary. Remember what it is. There is a way where you can extract the entire information, classification report. So I have to import classification report first. Classification report. So if I put classification report and same way give y and y predicted. It would give same accuracy of same. We had around 96 point something accuracy. So it's done that. It gives me a recall. It gives me a precision. It gives me an F1 score. F1 score is nothing but precision plus recall divided by twice of precision and recall. It's a way to look at this and this in conjunction with each other. Now, the way to read it is, because we are interested in default, default is 1. This is what we would read. So if we want to predict default, our precision is 0.52, our recall is 0.19. This is what? 0.52, 0.19. Same values come up here. Or this is our accuracy score for the model. And you remember when you asked multi-class, what happens? That's when these figures come into picture where you have multiple classes. It will calculate macro average and weighted average by putting weights to different classes. But if it is just two classes, you need not worry about these two. And you would see why you would never use linear regression to logistic regression for multi-class, because same way as we use logistic regression over linear regression because of certain nuances, multi-class classification has some other nuances where we will use other better algorithms for it rather than these. So this is how, this is all about linear regression you need to know. So you know how to use it on any data and how to read the accuracy, precision and recall, and why you need to have precision and recall. I think for next 15-20 minutes, let's go through all the question answers. Next session is going to be all about logistic regression and linear regression. Again, a revision, nothing new. I won't pick up anything new. Okay, so I think I'll stop here. All this material is already uploaded. As most of you suggested, today evening, I will add a lot of exercises which you can do for both logistic and linear regression that might help you with your practice.
Bharat, what I would suggest is if you could, when you're uploading those exercises, I mean, depending on the complexity from low to high, if you could do it similar to what you did last time, right? Every day of the week, spend an hour on this exercise or the next exercise. So that would help actually.
Okay, like you want me to put it like this, day one, do this exercise.
Exactly,
day
one. Yeah.
Okay, I'll do that. So we are in week 6. So week 7 material, you will have day 1, 2, 3, 4 with 5 exercises. For 2 exercises every day, because these exercises shouldn't take much time. I'll put 2 notebooks with exercise. All the exercises would have a solution also to it. But what I will urge is, don't look at the solution. Try to do it yourself. If you can't, try to Google the answer. If you can't find it on Google, if you have tried enough, then put it on WhatsApp and then look at the solution. Okay, because Googling, the ability to ask the right kind of question on Google and finding an answer is also quite a good skill to have. So I'll put this up. Okay, so unless if you guys have any questions, I'll take questions now.
Bharat, I had one more question. So last time when we did linear regression, right, you had used a particular model factory to get a complete summary where you had shown us the all the coefficients and the R square value, etc. Right. So can you fit logistical regression into a similar sort of a factory? I was trying to get a reference to what particular library you had used.
I had used OLS, right? OLS.linear model.
Yeah.
So you have OLS available for this as well, but I would not recommend it because you really need not get into all of these statistics. As long as you're able to understand what accuracy is, what your precision recall are, you would never ever bother into figuring it out. Like we interpreted coefficients in linear regression, A and B, alpha, beta, whatever we call it, right? In here also, there are coefficients. Like if you see for this model, you will have coefficients. These are the alpha, beta, gammas, and you will have the...
I don't think we can see your screen.
Oh, you can't. Now can you?
Yeah.
The same way for this model also, you can see all the intercepts. You can see all the model intercepts and coefficients. Why I didn't show you was you would never actually use it in real life. Like, how does it matter what the coefficient is? You would never be, your model would just predict. And you would see whether it is predicting right or wrong. You would never actually analyze a model, then explain why model functions like something. So unless you are into, you want to learn so that you are able to build a totally new type of model, you would never actually get into how a model predicts and the internals of it, explaining the coefficients. Because I wanted to give you some intuition on linear regression, that's why I explained. But otherwise, as you see, 99% of the models would have coefficients which run into millions, and these won't be interpretable so easily. So these, like linear regression would have maximum 4 to 5 coefficients, and logistic regression has as many coefficients as there are number of columns, number of predictors. So we had 3 predictors and hence 3 coefficients. Once you come to things like random forest, neural networks, these would run into millions and you would never actually see it. So all you would ever bother about is this difference between what you predicted and what actually is, and these kind of reports where you measure accuracy, precision, and recall. And that's why I'm not going deep into this, because no one would ever use it in real life or anywhere. In fact, I've never seen anyone using these.
Okay, so as a thumb rule, here what is important in logistical regression is accuracy, precision, and recall. And in linear regression, you would always look at the R square value and the...
Perfect, R square value. In fact, just the R square, and there is one more value called adjusted R square when you're doing multiple, when you have quite a lot of predictors, you would see adjusted R square instead of R square. It comes right below R square.
Okay. Okay.
That's about it. So, in fact, you don't even need to understand anything about report. As long as you know what your R square figure is or what your adjusted R square is, and for classification, what your accuracy, precision, recall is, you would never ever bother to find out more. All you care about is you run a dozen models, whichever model performs the best, you use that model to predict, and it just predicts.
Okay.
I had one question.
Sure.
So with this model, like at a top level, what could be a reason why it performed so badly?
Oh, because we have just built a very, very basic. We have not done any tuning. We have not done. Usually, these are very base fundamental models. In real life, you would never use something as simple as a... Okay, so I think you have asked a very, very fundamental question. I want to take some time to answer that. Saurabh, is that you?
Yeah, that's me.
Nice question, good question. Let me quickly share my screen. I don't know what's wrong with this. So what did we fundamentally do? We have something that we wanted to predict, and we have some things which help us predict. Now, assumption, fundamental assumption of using any machine learning is we use some things called features to predict something called Y. Now, you remember first few sessions I told Y is a combination of information plus noise. And our objective via any algorithm is to extract the information and distill away the noise. Now, with this, we are making an inherent assumption that Y is dependent or is driven by X1, X2, X4, X3. There might be a lot of other things which might actually be influencing Y, which we don't have sight to, right? So in our case, we used an example of default. Now, we are trying to predict default given a person is a student, what is his balance, what is income. There might be a lot of other factors which might actually be driving the default beyond these, for which we don't have sight to. So a lot of times your model performance given some data is purely function of the ability of these things to predict this. Now, let's say a default might be better predicted by your outstanding balance plus do you have any other loan or not. But here you don't have sight to your other loans, right? And hence, this cannot be very accurately predicted by only these three. So you remember when I gave full context of what this modeling was about? So what Citibank did was it had tracked 230 plus of these type of features, which they believe are a good way of predicting default. We have taken only three of these, and that's why our precision recall scores are so low. So as you add more of these features and add more data, your performance goes up drastically. And that's primarily the reason why our model performed so badly. If we add those other features, it would have performed much better. As we add in general more features, your predictive power increases exponentially. That is the reason why this particular model performed so badly. In real life, you would never have such less amount of data. You would have hundreds of these predictors and millions of rows of data. And that's how you usually do predictions. So I had subsetted this data by orders of magnitude to be able to simplify the fundamental concept behind logistic regression, and took this as a toy example. And that's why it wasn't able to predict. So while accuracy was high, but the forecasting power measured by precision and recall were so low. Did that answer it sufficiently?
Yeah, got it. But is there any way using just these parameters that we can make a logistical regression work well, like something apart from what we have done?
Logistic regression, you cannot, because that's what logistic regression does. Perhaps you can use some other complex models like, you can in fact use logistic regressions if you tweak some of these. Let's say you try to engineer data. So you induce something called non-linearities into a model. So just like how in linear regression we combine student and income by student times income, you can explore student times income and put that here, do a multiplication of these two, or do a multiplication of balance and income, and see whether it is a better predictor of default. So model machine learning in essence is trying out all the combinations and picking up the model which gives you the best performance. But it is theoretically possible by engineering features like multiplying balance and income, or taking a square of income or log of balance instead and trying that. And that's why these pipelines are so useful, because then you can just change one parameter in a pipeline and then it would change your entire data. And then you can again put it into same pipe flow where you can predict, measure accuracy score, change something, do the prediction, measure the accuracy score, and then do it over and over again. But there are limitations, because you really cannot predict more than what is available in this data. So two ways to do it would be, first, data engineering. That would not give much yield. In sense, your predictive power might go up from, let's say, 63% to a 65%. Next step is to use better or more complicated algorithms like a random forest or an isolation forest or a neural network. That's what would increase it to, let's say, from 60 to order of 80, 85. But beyond that, it's really, if you don't have the data, you can't do much.
Okay, got it.
Any other question anyone might have? Or if not questions, any suggestions that anyone might, because we have done 6 weeks now, I think you all would now get a hang of how to, what works for you, what doesn't work, is it too fast, is it too slow, are the exercises helpful? So what do you guys want me to do to make it better for you? Okay, so
the exercise was a very good idea. Like, it gives a good way to understand if we have actually understood.
Practice a question.
Yeah, practice exercises. Yeah, that's a good idea. I think speed-wise, it's pretty good. I'm good with that.
Yeah, I think it also depends on our workload over the week, right? So, I mean, to be honest, taking out an hour or a couple of hours every day, sometimes because of the work, the office work as well. So we have to basically manage our time better. I think there's no problem with the materials and the exercises that you're giving.
No, I think that's going to be your biggest challenge, because after work, you're already left with very less time. And that becomes a question of managing time between your family or doing your own things. So yeah, that is always going to be a very, very tough decision. But your pace of learning would grow as and when, because learning something very new at the onset takes some time. But once you get a hang of things, so linear regression, it took you 3 classes. Before linear regression, even to understand Python, we covered 4 classes. Logistic regression was this 1 class. So increasingly, as you would see, your returns from whatever time you put, when you put the same time, your returns would keep increasing. So keep on it. I know it's very, very tough, and I'm totally fine with slowing down the pace or having same topic covered on multiple weeks or having a break in between. So I'm, however you guys want it, I'll do it that way. So, but yeah, keep on it, hang in there. I know it's a little tough to manage time. But it is very rewarding. When I was learning it, I had to struggle quite a lot. A lot of people in this class are the people I used to travel quite frequently with. I had to sacrifice quite a lot of my travel, my things that I really enjoyed doing. But yeah, as a side effect, after a year of hanging on, I think I understand quite a lot about machine learning. I've been able to use it to switch career in my own office. So it comes with time. Hang in there. I think it's just a matter of time. Sooner or later, it is bound to yield and give you returns.
Yep. Thanks, Bharat.
Okay. So I think we have a WhatsApp group now. We have 6 week worth of coverage. We have done 6 sessions now. We understand Python. We understand linear regression. To some extent, logistic regression and data monging. Next week, we'll cover the same things again. Meanwhile, today evening, I'm going to put up exercises for both linear regression and logistic regression. Through the week, if you have any challenges understanding something or if you want any other support, please drop in the note at WhatsApp group. It's going to be tough few weeks initially, but that's why we are here as a group to help each other out. So thanks everyone for your time. I'll see you again next week.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for it.
Thank you.